What's up, you beautiful bastards? Hope you're having a fantastic Wednesday. Welcome back to the Philip DeFranco Show, and let's just jump into it. And the first thing we're going to talk about today, one of the most requested stories today, and that is the crazy story around Chanel Jazzy Rowe. On Monday, Jazzy, a University of Hartford freshman, went live on Facebook to share a story about what's been going on between her and her roommate. Her roommate is later identified as Rihanna Bertou, but Chanel doesn't name her in the stream. And in that stream, she says ever since she moved in, her roommate barely acknowledges her presence.
So I basically felt like I was unwanted in my own room, you know, like I was ignored. I was like a ghost in my own room, you know, like I was disrespected, and not like physically, but like if the person was to walk into the room and see me doing work, like she'll turn off the light and just walk out.
She also mentioned that during the time that she had been living with Brianna, she'd been getting sick.
While I've been here, I've been getting sick. It started with throat pain. And I thought maybe because it's cold up here, colder up here, I'm just probably catching a cold. It got to the point where I had extreme throat pain that I couldn't sleep, to the point where I couldn't speak. So I decided, let me go to the health clinic on campus because I can't let another day go by, you know what I'm saying? Because it's got so worse. So I went to the health clinic. They did 3 tests and they gave me antibiotics. Took the antibiotic. The 3 tests that they did came back negative.
But they couldn't figure out exactly what was wrong, and the only thing they knew is that she had some type of bacteria in her throat causing her pain. So she has to spend a lot of money traveling back and forth between New York and Connecticut, seeing doctors, missing classes for treatment. And all the while, problems with her roommate continue. She feels unwanted in her own room, and she decides to move out. So on October 17th, Chanel was in the process of slowly moving to another room when Brianna asks if she's moving out. So Chanel tells Brianna. Brianna then goes to her phone. Chanel assumes that she's just texting her friends to let them know. But as Chanel was leaving, her neighbor and 2 RAs approached her and showed her an Instagram post from Brianna. Brianna had posted on Instagram bragging about everything she had done to get her roommate to move out. The post reads,
"Finally did it. Your girl got rid of her roommate. After 1.5 months of spitting in her coconut oil, putting moldy clam dip in her lotions, rubbing used tampons on her backpack, putting her toothbrush places where the sun doesn't shine, and so much more. I can finally say goodbye, Jamaican Barbie."
And while she doesn't have proof of this, Chanel says that she was also told Brianna had posted in the past photos of her eating. And with those pictures, they'd have captions saying things along the lines of, "If she only knew where those utensils have been." She goes on to show pictures that were included in the post. Pictures of her packages, the backpack, the clam dip. She says she's been sleeping with period blood next to her face and using that coconut oil on her body, face, and lips.
"I usually just keep that bag like on the corner. And in my old room, I used to have my desk in front of my bed. Basically, I was sleeping with period blood in my face for a month and change and had no idea."
Unsurprisingly, she's scared to use her own stuff now. And so once Chanel finds out this was happening, the university's public safety department comes in, they remove her contaminated belongings, she files a police report, but she says the school originally told her that she may or may not hear back about the crimes committed against her. She also says she was asked to sign a no contact agreement, meaning that her and her former roommate could have no communication with one another, saying that later when the school staff came to collect her keys, they said they wanted to make sure she understood her no contact agreement also meant that the situation was over. Also saying they told her if she spoke about this, she would be removed from campus housing.
"Well, just to let you know, the situation is over, so don't speak about it or else you can be removed from the residential side of campus." Basically saying I can't live on campus. Like that will happen if I speak about the situation, saying the situation's over.
But also noting the staff member who initially had her sign the agreement assured her that was not the case. Chanel says as more time passes, she becomes frustrated with how the situation is being handled, saying she was told nothing could happen until public safety was finished with their investigation, but it had been nearly 2 weeks. But still nothing had been done, so she was worried the university was going to try and sweep this under the rug. And so the whole reason she streamed this live on Facebook is she said she refused to be silent.
"I don't want to be another statistic, you know what I'm saying? Because colleges, like, it could be a rape situation or something serious, you know what I'm saying? Anything serious. And they just brush it under the rug. And then they just leave it until the situation disappears. Like, they don't take care of it at all."
She also argued that race might have played a role in this case. And, I mean, just based off of Jamaican Barbie, I don't think that's a crazy assumption. Now, after the live stream, this story blew up all over social media. Justice for Jazzy was trending on Twitter. A bunch of people were contacting the school demanding some action. Some, as I mentioned earlier, found the roommate's name. They shared that as well. And finally, after a ton of criticism, the university responded. The university tweeted out a statement, and in it, they said that the university public safety had turned over the case to local authorities for prosecution, and an arrest had been made. University of Hartford President Greg Woodward also issuing a statement to the university community later that night, reading, "One of our students was the alleged victim of bullying, and her story was shared across social media. Let me be clear. The accused student's behavior was reprehensible and does not reflect the values of our institution. Let me also be clear that I am confident the university has taken all steps to pursue this matter seriously and will continue to do so." Upon learning of the incident, public safety immediately ensured that the victim was relocated to a safe location, notified local authorities, and provided support for their investigation. The accused student was subsequently arrested by the West Hartford Police Department, and her case will proceed through the legal process. The university will continue to precisely execute our defined process outlined in the Code of Student Conduct. The university strictly and swiftly followed all procedural and legal processes related to this alleged event. Claims to the contrary are based on misinformation. The incident has brought about accusations of racism, and I want you to know that I hear and share your anger and frustration. Acts of racism, bias, bullying, or other abusive behaviors will not be tolerated on this campus. I pledge to do everything in my power to work with our community to address related concerns together. Now, as far as Brianna, she told police that she, quote, began to lash out due to a hostile environment. This caused by the victim's rude behavior, not compromising, and her, quote, posting Snapchat videos of me sleeping and making fun of me snoring. She also told police she requested a room change on October 11th, but was unsuccessful. She reportedly admitted to licking the victim's silverware and smearing her bodily fluids on the backpack, but denied tampering with lotions and cosmetics, saying those were just lies to appear funny. And as far as the arrest, the record shows she was arrested on October 28th, and she was charged with third-degree criminal mischief and second-degree breach of the peace. These charges are both Class B misdemeanors, which each carry a maximum sentence of 6 months in prison, along with a potential fine. And she was scheduled to appear in Hartford Community Court today for her arraignment and is currently free on $1,000 bail. Additionally, she's also facing possible discipline from the university, but it's not clear if that will result in her losing her four-year $20,000 scholarship. And my response to this is, what a garbage person! My favorite thing from that report is she's like, yes, body fluids, I did that. But clam dip in her lotion? That's ridiculous. That was a joke. You're garbage, and I think it would be hard to argue you're not garbage. Let's say Brianna's telling the truth. Chanel, she was rude. She took that Snapchat video of her snoring and made fun of her. How is the response to that smearing period blood on her backpack? Also, if you somehow keep your scholarship through all of this, shame on you, Hartford. I mean, if there wasn't already scrutiny around how you were handling this situation because you really only reacted after Chanel made that Facebook Live video, which, hey, I think there can be an argument of making sure the chain of custody, everything's on the up and up so that it can be handled properly.
But
if additionally Brianna is not punished at that school, I don't know. I just think there's no way to justify it. But that said, of course, this is the Philip DeFranco Show. I have my personal takeaway. I'd love to know your thoughts on this story. Also, additional bonus points question. Do you have any horror stories of someone that you roomed with in college? I'd love to hear some of those. And then let's talk about the newest and one of the most high-profile people in Hollywood to be accused of sexual assault and sexual harassment today, and that is Brett Ratner. Brett Ratner, of course, massive producer, director, directed X-Men The Last Stand, Hercules, Tower Heist, Rush Hour 1, 2, and 3, producer of the Horrible Bosses movie, executive producer for The Revenant, War Dogs. And today, the LA Times published 6 allegations from 6 women against Ratner. We had actress and model Natasha Henstridge speaking out, saying when she was 19 years old, she went to Ratner's house to watch movies with a group of people. She says she fell asleep at some point. When she woke up, she realized everyone else had already left. Saying when she tried to leave, Ratner blocked her way to the door. He began touching himself. She alleges that he forced her to perform oral sex on him, saying he strong-armed me in a real way. He physically forced himself on me. At some point, I gave in and he did his thing. Olivia Munn also speaking out, saying she was asked to take a meal to Ratner's trailer on the set of After the Sunset while she was still an aspiring actress. Saying while she was there, he came out of the bathroom without pants on and he was masturbating. Saying he walked out with his belly sticking out, no pants on, shrimp cocktail in one hand, and he was furiously masturbating in the other. Adding, before I could literally even figure out where to escape or where to look, he ejaculated. She says she contacted her lawyer about this incident, but was dissuaded from moving forward. And it's also important to note that this is not the first time Munn has spoken out on this. Olivia Munn wrote about the incident in a 2010 collection of essays without identifying him, but Ratner identified himself. He denied that he masturbated in front of her, but did say they used to date, which Munn denies. He even said, I banged her a few times, but I forgot her. But then he apologized for the statement soon after and said it wasn't true. Also, Munn said right after the release of her essay, she ran into Ratner at a party where he asked her why she hated him. He, apparently unhappy with her response of, it's more of a dislike, responded by saying, why, I bought 10 of your magazines and came all over them. Others were reportedly there and confirmed that encounter. Actress Jamie Ray Newman also speaking out. She said that she was seated next to Ratner on an Air Canada flight, saying that after the flight took off, he began to describe things he wanted to do with her in explicit detail and showed her naked photos of his then girlfriend. Newman saying, he was graphically describing giving me oral sex and how he was addicted to it. She said immediately after the experience, she told a handful of friends and family. They have also confirmed this. And for the sake of time, I'll link to the article and the other accusations down below. Now, in response to this, Ratner's attorney, Martin Singer, categorically denied the allegations in a 10-page letter to the LA Times. He refuted each of the claims separately and then vouched for Ratner, saying, I have represented Mr. Ratner for 2 decades and no woman has ever made a claim against him for sexual misconduct or sexual harassment. Furthermore, no woman has ever requested or received any financial settlement from my client. And that's seeming to be a reference to the O'Reilly situation, the Weinstein situation. Good women being paid in settlements there, but with Ratner, that hasn't been the case. And so on that note, a question I want to pass off to you is, does that make you think differently about that situation? Or no, we're still seeing six women coming out here with accusations. That's still a lot of smoke for there to be no fire. I'd love to know what you're thinking here. And then let's talk about the updates around Manafort and Gates. If you missed the Monday show, here's a quick summary of what we've already talked about. Paul Manafort and Richard Gates have been indicted on 12 crimes, all of them very serious, but the main two, you have conspiracy against the United States and conspiracy to launder money. These have massive sentences. Monday, they were asked to surrender themselves to the FBI. They both did so. By 1 p.m. Eastern time, they both appeared in court. They both pled not guilty. Paul Manafort was released on a $10 million bond, Gates on a $5 million bond, and they reportedly had to surrender their passports. They are due back in court tomorrow. That's what we knew then, and now more information has come out. On Tuesday, the prosecution under Robert Mueller submitted more paperwork to the courts, and they reveal some requests from the prosecution, as well as some information that makes Manafort and Gates seem pretty sketchy. As far as the ask here, the prosecution is asking that both Manafort and Gates be placed under house arrest. The documents reading, both of the defendants have significant financial resources. Both have substantial overseas ties, including assets held abroad, significant foreign work connections, and significant travel abroad. Those aspects of the defendant's history and characteristics evidence a risk of flight. And so with that request, they would have to stay at home. They could only leave to see their lawyer, go to a religious function. They'd have to check in once a day with the FBI. And the court has agreed and placed them on house arrest. Now that said, let's talk about those significant financial resources and substantial overseas ties that the prosecutors were talking about. The document details that they both aren't just accused of hiding some money from the United States, but we're talking about $75 million. We're talking $75 million in ill-gotten gains from working with Ukraine's former pro-Russian president and other foreign groups. And this money is said to be hidden in accounts throughout Cyprus, the Grenadines, Seychelles, and even the UK. And as far as the difference between the two men, Manafort's net worth is believed to be up to 10 times larger than Gates. But it's also important to note they don't know the exact amount of money he actually has. And this seems to be because Manafort has been all over the place. On loan applications from 2012, he wrote that he had $19 million. On loan applications in May of 2016, he said he had $136 million. So the options here seem to be he made a ton of money in those 4 years, or he's lying. But if he did make that money, it appears that he hid that amount from the government. But we're not done, because in August of 2016, 3 months after claiming he had $136 million, also when he was campaign manager for Trump, he said on one application he had $28 million, and on another one he had $63 million. So understandably sketchy. On one application, he's essentially saying that he lost $110 million in 3 months. But then on another application in that same month, there is a $35 million difference in what he's claiming. Also, remember how I said Manafort and Gates had to give up their passports? It turns out that unlike most Americans, Manafort had 3 passports. They were all U.S. passports with different numbers. He reportedly had submitted 10 passport applications in the last 10 years. Now, before moving forward, it is important to note here, it is possible for the average citizen to have 2 U.S. passports. But it usually involves a situation like you're traveling between 2 countries and one denies you because you entered from a certain other country. Example, if you want to go to Saudi Arabia, they will deny you if you have an Israeli passport stamp. So the State Department will give you a second one. There's also situations like if you're traveling to a country that requires a visa in advance and you plan to go to a non-visa country in the meantime. Like let's say you want to go to China, you need to get your passport stamped first at a consulate or an embassy. So you mail it in, this takes less time, but you want to travel to England in the meantime. Obviously, these are very specific situations. They're somewhat rare situations, but that's not even considering we're talking 3 passports here. Especially since we're talking about Manafort, who wasn't a diplomat. And another sketchy thing that Manafort and sometimes Gates did, this year alone, Manafort went to Mexico, China, and Ecuador with a phone and email accounts registered to different fake names. And so that's ultimately where we are right now. Like I said, they are going to go back to court tomorrow. It will be interesting to see what happens, what the defense is, but we'll have to wait to see. And then let's talk about the terror attack in Manhattan yesterday. Yesterday around 3 p.m. Eastern, a rented Home Depot truck entered the West Street pedestrian bike path at high speeds where it struck multiple people. The truck then continued and hit a school bus before it ultimately came to a stop. The suspect then got out of the car with what we know now to be a paintball gun and a pellet gun. The suspect then ran through traffic, and after a confrontation with Officer Brian Nash, he was shot in the abdomen and was taken to a hospital under police custody. According to one law enforcement official, quote, he jumped out of the truck with a pellet gun, yelled Allahu Akbar, and the First Precinct lit him up. Also, those injured and killed in this attack were largely tourists. Reportedly, 8 people were killed, 12 others injured in this attack, which would actually make this the deadliest terror attack in New York since 9/11. And here's what the investigation has found out so far. Authorities found an image of an Islamic State flag and notes that were in Arabic that were pledges to the Islamic State. And they found these in and around the vehicle. 3 officials also said the suspect had been on the FBI's radar, but that it was unrelated to this incident. As far as the suspect, we know that he immigrated legally from Uzbekistan in 2010 and earlier this year settled in New Jersey with his wife and 3 kids. At this point, the wife has denied any prior knowledge of this attack. That said, it seems that he has been planning the attack for weeks. It also seems that he has been inspired by Islamic State attacks.
It appears that Mr. had been planning this for a number of weeks. He did this in the name of ISIS, And along with the other items recovered at the scene was some notes that further indicate that.
And in response to this attack, we saw President Trump tweeting, "In New York City, looks like another attack by a very sick and deranged person. Law enforcement is following this closely, not in the USA. We must not allow ISIS to return or enter our country after defeating them in the Middle East and elsewhere. Enough. My thoughts, condolences, and prayers are the victims and families of the New York City terrorist attack. God and your country are with you." Then adding, "I have just ordered Homeland Security to step up our already extreme vetting program. Being politically correct is fine, but not for this. The terrorists came into our country through what is called the Diversity Visa Lottery Program. Chuck Schumer beauty. I want merit-based." And you might remember in August, Trump actually endorsed the RAISE Act, which would change the visa system. And this would eliminate the lottery program and create a merit-based point system instead of ones based on family ties. But that did not receive enough support to move forward. But that said, in response to the Trump tweets, Chuck Schumer tweeted, "I guess it's not too soon to politicize a tragedy. President Trump should be focusing on the real solution, anti-terrorism funding, which he proposed to cut in his most recent budget." And just to fact-check Trump and Schumer here, one, it is a fact that Chuck Schumer was an original sponsor back in 1990 as far as this program's concerned, but it's also important to note that it was a bipartisan push. It was signed through by President Bush. But also, it's important to note that in 2013, Chuck Schumer actually proposed ending diversity visas. Senator Jeff Flake also going to Twitter to confirm this, tweeting, "Actually, the Gang of Eight, including Senator Schumer, did away with the diversity visa program as part of broader reforms. I know, I was there. In fact, had the Senate Gang of Eight bill passed the House, it would have ended the visa lottery program and increased merit-based visas." And then as far as Schumer's claim around budget cuts, depending on how you look at it, it is true and not true. Trump's last budget plan is actually proposing a $4.7 billion increase into Homeland Security. But at the same time, it would cut $583 million from, quote, critical counterterrorism programs that DHS administers. Additionally, it would cut $35.9 million from the Complex Coordinated Terrorist Attacks Program, also cutting $10 million from the Countering Violent Extremism budget. And so, of course, you have people saying those cuts are ridiculous, that is actually harmful to the country, especially considering $1.6 billion is being dedicated to the border wall. But that's where we are right now. As far as New York is moving forward. The Halloween parade that they had planned continued on last night. The New York City Marathon, which is on November 5th, is still planned to happen, but will have increased security. And really to that, I say there's no surprise. As someone that's originally from New York and from the Bronx, if you're new here, you might not know that, you can't break New York. You can hurt it, but if you think you're going to break it, you're going to stop it, you can go fuck yourself. And of course, around a situation like this, I'd love to know your thoughts here. We've seen attacks and violence from people of all different backgrounds recently. What do you think about these proposed changes, whether it be about diversity visas or budget cuts? Also, what are your thoughts on the too soon to politicize aspect? I think there's a really interesting debate there, but what I do find very interesting is who says it when they say it. It was just very interesting to me to see very different reactions based on the attacks. It felt like when I looked online, a lot of the same people after the Vegas attack who were saying, you know, we can't talk about guns right now. It's too soon to politicize this. We can't do it now. Immediately after this attack, say we have to change things now. Do it now. Something has to change. This can't stand. And I say that as someone that is actually pro-gun. I mean, I'm common sense pro-gun, but pro-gun. I just find it very interesting. I'd love to know your thoughts on that as well. And that's actually where I'm going to end today's show. Of course, if you like this video, you like what I try and do on this channel, hit that like button. If you're new here, hit that subscribe button. That way you make sure you don't miss these daily videos, which actually, if you did miss yesterday's show, if you want to catch up, click or tap right there to watch that. Or if you want to see today's brand new behind the scenes vlog, click or tap right there to watch that ridiculousness. But that said, of course, as always, my name's Philip DeFranco. You've just been filled in. I love yo faces, and I'll see you tomorrow.